Do you like cucumbers but wish they tasted different and were filled with fluff that cleaned up oil spills? Well then, the milkweed might be for you. If you know one thing about milkweed, it's probably its connection with monarch butterflies and how the caterpillars use it as food. But today I'm going to talk about something that gets a lot less press coverage, the seed pods. When I was a young lad and bad at IDing plants, I thought this was a type of wild cucumber. And while the pods do look kind of cucumber-esque, that's pretty much where the similarities end. I mean, these are also edible in their immature state. Cucumbers we also eat in their immature state usually, but you can eat them mature. These, unlike a true cucumber, as they get mature, they wouldn't make good eating. They start to toughen up and just get really dry, and the inside will turn from something edible and soft into just a boatload of fluff. And this fluff, or silk, or floss, it's often known as, well, the seed pod cracks open, and this stuff comes out attached to the seeds, kind of like a dandelion. You'll see a bit of fluff with a seed dangling off the end. Now, this silk here, it is large, and there is a lot of it. So the practical forager in you, or the textile manufacturer in you, might be thinking, ah, fiber. That is something I can use to make rope, or cloth, or some such thing like that. Now, that might work, but this really isn't the best fiber for those sorts of things. There are some records of it being done, for instance, amongst the indigenous in North America and some people groups in Africa. This is a widespread group of plants. But milkweed floss has always had one downside that a lot of other commercial fibers don't so much. See, with the naked eye, this stuff looks like a pretty generic strand of fiber. But if you zoom in with a microscope, it turns out each strand is actually a smooth and very thin-walled tube. Very neat and tidy, but one of the main reasons cotton or wool work so well is that their fibers aren't so neat and tidy and can hook and snag onto each other, holding together. With wool, that's mainly because of the rough, scaly sides. And with cotton, it's more to do with its shape, how it twists around and crimps. Milkweed floss, being straight and smooth like this, well, it has neither feature. So the fibers don't stick together well, and because of that thin tube shape, they're also kind of brittle. Now, people have been trying to use this for commercial applications for a fair while, at least as far back as 1746, when a German guy tried to experiment with it, using it in types of padding and velvet and a couple other things like that. His findings and those from the next few such guys were generally the same. The fibers didn't spin well, didn't hold colors from dye, and the plants were hard to grow from seed in cultivation. But fast forward to the 20th century, and people started to see it in a new light, owing to another special feature here. Turns out, those little thin-walled tubes are coated in wax. Combine that with the hollow tube shape, and you have a pretty good combination for a few certain applications. The 20th century, World War II rolled around in there, and naturally, synthetic fibers being much less common at this time, a lot of the supplies the army used were made from materials from all around the world. Necessary, perhaps, but it puts you in a risky situation when, well, war is a time when people famously don't always get along very well. And if your enemies suddenly cut off one of your trade routes, well, that could suddenly leave you in quite a pickle. And that was exactly the pickle that the Allies found themselves in. See, there's flotation devices in their planes and their boats. They were made with the fibers of the kapok tree, a large tropical tree growing at the time mainly in Java, or at least that's where the Allies mainly sourced it from. And that was all fine and dandy until, well, Japan invaded China in 1937, starting the war in the Pacific, and one thing led to another, and soon Japan had cut off the Allies' trading route to Java. And, well, studies have shown that people tend to survive better when not submerged underwater, so the Allies decided this just wouldn't do. And something had to be done to replace their kapok fibers. So, milkweed floss. They've got that thin tube shape, and turns out it's such a thin tube that 90% of their volume is air. Therefore, nice and light. But put them underwater and soon that'll be 90% water, right? Well, not necessarily. We have that wax coating. And now, not only is wax actually hydrophobic, as in it repels water, but in doing so, it also traps a thin layer of air along the fiber. So add those things together and you have a fantastically buoyant and waterproof life jacket filling. And milkweed is incredibly common. So in Canada and the States, the government put out a call to action. Don't let our soldiers sink. Two bags save one life. With most of the men away fighting the war and the women kind of taking over the workforce at home, the children were put to work here. Back then, there were still a lot of tiny schools scattered around rural areas with easy access to the pastures and prairies where these plants grow. Kids would go out with onion bags and bring them back filled for 15 cents a bag, 20 cents if they dried them themselves. Whole schools and 4-H groups would join in on this, after which the pods would be sent away to a converted lumber mill in Petoskey, Michigan, America's only milkweed processing plant. Here they would dry about 1,000 bags an hour and lightly crush the seeds so that they could separate the seeds from the floss. The result was a success, with about 1.5 billion pods collected over the course of the war, equating to about 5 million kilograms, or about 1.2 million life vests. Unfortunately, still a lot of deaths in that war, but at least less of them were from drowning. So it looked like a promising fiber, but unfortunately the market didn't last. After the war, synthetic fibers really took off and kind of replaced the whole market for them. And for the most part, that was that. But it's not the end of the story. It has undergone a small resurgence of interest recently, for different purposes this time though. Smaller scale too, but definitely some interesting applications. To list a few, well, first off, insulation. Turns out milkweed floss is pretty warm. I mean, that one's not a new discovery per se. The indigenous have been using it, for instance, to line cradles and stuff like that for long into the distant past. But in terms of commercial applications, a few companies have started experimenting with doing hypoallergenic pillow and quilt stuffings, and a Canadian company recently also started making parkas lined with milkweed fluff as well. And this makes sense because the tube shape of the fibers means there's lots of isolated little chambers all throughout, which slows down the movement of heat going through, making it a really good insulator, apparently comparable to goose down. Although at least one study has argued that it's actually significantly improved if you mix it with goose down, making for better thermal properties and texture as well. Second, the same goes for insulating from sound, and some car manufacturers have experimented with using it to keep the inside of the car quiet. Third, and this is one that I'm curious to see where it progresses, is the idea of making bioactive fabrics with bacteria and other sorts of cells being grown inside the tubes. But probably the most noteworthy use in recent years is another potentially life-saving ocean-related technology. It's no secret that even relatively small oil spills can have devastating effects on local environments and human populations as well. Oil floats on the top of the water and spreads out very quickly to cover a large area. There have been many ways this has been dealt with, but there's often some sort of trade-off between efficiency and safety. For instance, some of the more efficient methods, such as spraying chemicals to dissolve the oil into the water column or to solidify the oil, making it easier to remove from the top of the water, those chemicals can be toxic to marine life a lot of the time. One other method that's currently used is to throw some pads of polypropylene into the water, which can float on top of the water and absorb the oil and just keep floating there until it can be retrieved. The one problem being polypropylene is very, very slow to break down after it's served its purpose already. And here's where milkweed floss is really promising. See, that waxy coating doesn't only repel water, it also actually attracts oil. Scientists have noted that when put into contact with oil, it initially gathers the oil on its outside, but the oil gradually wicks its way through capillary action into the inside of the hollow tubes. And it turns out, not only does milkweed floss break down much more easily once it's been removed from the site than polypropylene would, but it's also a lot more absorbent, even as much as 4 times as absorbent as polypropylene. It depends a lot on how the floss is packed and what sort of oil is being absorbed, but scientists found that a single gram of floss can absorb as much as 30 or even 100 grams of oil. A Quebec-based company has actually started farming and processing milkweed for just this purpose, distributing packs of the stuff to Canada's national parks in case of an emergency. So definitely a promising use for these things. But for the last use, and probably my favorite use for these things, pretty flammable. I mean, you know, maybe good as a fire starter. Not much beyond that. They burn so quickly, but fun anyway. Ooh, still smoldering back here. Be responsible too. Use fire responsibly. Now, I did mention that when immature, these pods are edible. And actually, most of the milkweed plant has some sort of edible or practical value to humans. But it's a bit late in the season to show most of that. So maybe sometime in the future, there'll be a part two on the milkweed videos. I've got a lot of other videos on my backlog from my recent trips to Costa Rica, Peru, and Asia still. So those will probably come first. But as always, thank you for liking, commenting, and subscribing. And for more weird and wonderful plants from Manitoba and elsewhere in the world, join me next time on Ambling with Sam. Now I better put this out. This it's smoldering something over here.